So laptops don't really come any smaller than this here. This is a 7-inch Windows 10 laptop with a quad-core CPU, the Atom X7-8750. It has 8 GB of RAM, 128 GB of eMMC 4.5 storage, wireless AC, a 1080p screen that is fully laminated. It's only 7 inches and puts out 150 lumens of maximum brightness. So it's called the Pocket. And does that mean it's pocketable? Yes, it does. It folds down to just 18-19 millimeters and weighs just 504 grams. So it's super portable and very easy to carry around with you to put in a handbag or in large pockets if you do happen to have them. So the Pocket screen does support 5 touch points, and I've noticed that if you do have the screen upright, that when you do tap on it, it will rock around a little bit because of the feet placement. However, if you put the screen back further, it will then touch the bottom of the table and you don't have that issue. The screen will also recline, not completely flat, but almost better than most laptops. So along the bottom we have these 4 sturdy rubber feet, and what looks like a speaker is in fact the intake vent here for the CPU cooler. And on the right is where you will find the exit vent, so if you put your finger up here you can feel warm air coming out here. Now we don't have a lot of ports on here, but it's not bad when you think about this device. It's only a 7-inch screen, yet it's got a full-size USB 3 port that will power external hard drives. We have a micro HDMI port, 3.5mm out, and my favorite is the Type-C port on here, which does support data, charging, and video out simultaneously, so you can use Type-C docks like this one here that I have, allowing you to really connect up an external monitor and keyboard with just one plug, which is really good. Now the hinge on the device is really sturdy, it's very good, well made, the whole build quality overall is excellent, but they are missing one thing, one crucial thing I feel in the design here, which is a front facing webcam, which I feel they should have put on one of these side bezels here. They've got space for it, but I guess they had to make some compromises with the design with the limitations they have. Limitations of course pull through into the keyboard space. The amount of available space they have on here cannot fit a full size keyboard. That is understandable. They're only working with 7 inches, so they've made a lot of compromises here in the design. So typing on this keyboard, the key quality themselves and travel is very good. I have no issues with that, but some things just take a lot to get used to, and that is the space key, the way it's separated. And I found that typing on it a lot, when I go to type, for example, A, I end up hitting S because the caps lock is really the whole size, including the A of a standard caps lock, but they've cut it down to only a quarter-sized one here, and the same goes for other keys you can see along here with your punctuation and things. So very compromised keyboard, and it can be, to say the least, frustrating at times using this keyboard. I myself personally don't really want to write more than a few lines of a web address on this keyboard. Now the power button is set aside and it's away from the delete key and the backspace key, which is good, and has a firmer touch to it. So the resistance of the button is higher than the others, and it's not so easy to press. Now you will see 2 status LEDs in here. One will light up red when you're charging. The one on the right will flash white when it is in sleep mode. We've also got some function keys here along the top. And there is a print screen button, which is great to see on such a small device. Media controls, and then even a screen brightness shortcut via the function key. Now there's one thing I don't like about the keyboard, apart from it being cramped in the layout, is the keys that I've used have like a matte texture to them, so they show your sweat from your hands, oils, very easily, and I feel that in the long run, these buttons are going to wear and get a little bit dirty, the keys on the keyboard. Now we have a track point down here, because of course we don't have space for a full touchpad. Now this is great because I do use the touch screen often, but for the finer controls, with a little bit of practice, you can do some very fine movements with the touch point here. And if you're coming from, say, an IBM ThinkPad from way back or the Lenovo ThinkPads, then you'll be familiar with this. It's basically the same, controlled by pressure, and it does the job quite well for those smaller little detailed things. Now the mouse buttons on here, they are separated, so we still have the right and left, and a little bit awkward to use at the same time, but With a bit of practice, again, you do kind of get used to it. So the screen can be a little bit frustrating at times because everything is so small. Now you can increase the window scaling, but I'm going with what they have set by default, which is 100%. So to minimize and maximize things sometimes takes about 2 or 3 attempts, but you get used to it after a little while that sometimes it's just not going to work. So if you're someone that must have your touches register and be super accurate every time, this screen will frustrate you. But the screen itself is very nice. So 7 inches, it's an IPS, it has good colors, deep blacks, and the viewing angles are perfect on here because it is fully laminated. Now, one thing to note too, that the screen does not have an accelerometer in the hardware. So if you flip it up, the screen will not rotate automatically. That's not going to happen there. Now the maximum brightness is 250 lumens of brightness, which you may think not enough, but it is sufficient. And I find that it does the job quite well. But of course, outdoor use, it reflects a lot. So it's not really the greatest for that because the reflections will end up annoying you too. So the Pocket has some speakers that are located just down here. Let's have a listen to them. So for the size of the device, I feel the speakers aren't actually too bad. Now they're not high quality ones. I also wanted to comment too on the 3.5mm headphone jack. Now I've noticed that there's a little bit of static coming through that. I think that's something to do with the add-in chipsets, because with the Apollo Lakes, I'm not really getting that. So it's a little disappointing to see. And also there is a bit of a buzz and static through the microphone when you record sound. Now the microphone, there's a logo here, is located somewhere I feel around this area. So if you happen to be using the microphone and want to use the keyboard at the same time, you're going to pick up, of course, the feedback from the keys. So the Pocket is running Windows 10 Home and it activates. They've actually put the CD key inside the box. So if you want to do a fresh install, you've got it right there, nice and handy. So you see there that it's got 8 gigabytes of RAM. Now this RAM is not running at the fastest supported speed for the Atom X7Z8750, which is 1600 megahertz. The RAM only runs at 1066. So they've clocked it down, so a little bit slower, but it is at least running in dual channel. Now, another thing to point out too is free space on the eMMC. We get 103 gigabytes, which isn't too bad. But bear in mind, there is no micro SD card slot on here, so you can't expand the storage at all. And there is no SSD slot. So here is the Geekbench 4 score. Now it's a little bit slower, of course, than the Apollo Lakes, which are faster. Now the Apollo Lake N3450, which I've been reviewing a lot of lately, we'll get a score here of about 1400 for the single core score, and then the multi-core score on the Apollo Lake will be about 4000, so it's about 600 points slower there. But there's one key difference. The main difference is the GPU is quite a bit weaker on this model, and it will not natively decode VP9 or HEVC codecs, which the Apollo Lakes will. So there's a bit of a difference there. Now you notice that if you've got a keen eye, that my wireless range here, you've only got 1 or 2 bars. So this is the real weakness and the biggest con of this device is the wireless. So it comes with Broadcom wireless AC. And if I sit on top of my wireless router, I'm joking here, but I mean, very close to it, I can get these speeds, which are brilliant. These are good speeds, very, very good. But I walk over to the next room and the performance just plummets. It goes down quite a bit. And it happens to be probably the weakest device I have tested when it comes to wireless range and performance. Even weaker than, for example, those cheap mobile phones that I often review. It's really disappointing. Now, I think a lot of it's to do with the design. The antenna, I believe, is just in this space right down here, the plastic here. And because of the all-metal build, I do think it is blocking the performance of those antennas. So it's very well looking at the benchmarks, but overall performance, it's good at light tasks, but things like Chrome just don't run as good on the Atoms as they do on the Apollo Lake. So once you start to get a few tabs open in there, you can see with my website here, Tech Tablets, that it does have a bit of choppiness to it. The scrolling isn't as smooth as I would like, but Edge, of course, that's different. And you find that the scrolling of that is quite a bit better. So I normally just stick to Edge on the Atoms, because really Chrome performance isn't that great. Now you can play videos and things like that. You can stream in 4K. You can do minor Photoshop edits, but very light ones. All of that stuff is possible on an Atom as long as you've got a bit of patience. Here's the AnTuTu score, which surprised me. I didn't expect it to perform this well, but the CPU score is a bit higher here. So it got 110,000. Now the Apollo Lake M3450 will more or less get about 121,000. So it's not far away, but the 3D score is lower here than those Apollo Lakes. Now battery life, you can expect, this is my little test here that I did, around 7 hours of internet use. This is using Edge and Chrome at 25% brightness, which is still reasonably bright to use indoors with lights on, everything. I didn't have an issue there. Now it is very slow to charge. Even though the charge is 12 volts to amps, I found out that it's only charging at 5 volts, and as a result it will take just under 5 hours to fully charge when on, and if you turn it off it will take around 4 hours and 20 something minutes to fully charge. So quite slow there to charge the 7000 milliamp hour battery. And here is the internal Toshiba eMMC. So it's 4.5.1 spec, and these speeds for that spec of eMMC aren't actually too bad. Good 4Ks on there and very decent sequential writes and reads, so not too bad. It would have been better to have eMMC 5 spec or an SSD, of course, but I guess they'll be reserving that for future models if they ever do release them. Alright, so what about fan noise? Because it is actively cooled, not passively like the Atoms normally are. So there's three settings it has. So the first one is no fan, so no noise. The second is a very low, slow fan speed that you can't even really hear. It's on, I have to put my ear right up to it. And then the final one is when you're gaming, you can just hear the, it's audible. It's not loud or anything like that. It's quite a decent fan noise. It doesn't make a high-pitched whine. It doesn't really bother me that much, but yes, you can hear it in a very quiet room when it's running at 100%. So Windows Store games like Asphalt Extreme here, they run perfectly fine as long as you lower the settings. So what I've done is put the visual settings down to the fastest performance setting. On optimal, it was very choppy and laggy. But once I drop the settings down, you can see you're getting playable frame rates. League of Legends here now you can see is just playable, if you could even call it playable. It's 720p on the lowest settings, 20 frames per second, so running very slow. And really not that great, so the performance is quite a step behind the Apollo Lakes, which would be probably getting around 50, 40 frames per second in 1080p. Now a look at Counter-Strike Global Offensive. Now this is 800x600 Dust2 map, lowest visual settings. It is running very slow, 20 frames per second. Making it very hard to get a kill, but even with my skills, I probably couldn't anyway get one. So that is it for gaming. Let's have a look now at the temperatures. I'm just going to go over into Windows. Keep that running in the background so we can have a look now at what the thermals got up to with this gaming that I've been doing. So here we go, up to 73 degrees there, you can see. Hopefully just, it's quite small, the text. Naturally, because it's a small screen. But let's have a look now at the surface temperatures. So with my thermal probe, check now the surface temps. It does feel like it's getting quite hot to the touch. So we're seeing around 37 degrees. That's just around this area right here. Let's have a look now at the underside of it. Just around where the fan is, that's where the CPU is. That is getting reasonably warm now, 39 degrees. So it does get quite hot to the touch once you're pushing it hard, and even when charging it too, it gets hot. So to recap here, the build quality is excellent. It's very well made, it's put together great, there's no problems with the fit and finish. I can find no flaws with it whatsoever. It just feels premium, and it should for the price tag, which is one of the cons there. This is a very expensive little laptop here. We're talking around $500 US for a last gen chipset powered device. To me, that's way too pricey, and they really need to focus on lowering that price. So it's got a decent 1080p display, it's sharp, it's bright, it's got good colors, but it's a little hard to use the touch because of Windows and the screen being so small, you will often find missed touches. Same goes for the keyboard. It can be at times very frustrating to type on, especially with the caps lock and the space bar I found to be the biggest hurdles there, and often just resulting in the fact that I don't want to type on this keyboard. I'd rather plug in an external keyboard. And it is great that we have a Type-C port so we can output to our USB keyboards, our monitors, and drive all that. But bear in mind though, that the monitor maximum resolution you're gonna get out of that Type-C port is 1080p. That's a restriction from the Atom CPU. So the Apollo Lakes can go right up to 4K, but it's only 30 Hertz. But at least we've got more range there if you wanted to run, for example, 60 Hertz 1440p, that is possible, but not on this here. So the trackpad is quite accurate, and once you get the hang of it, it's a lot more better to use actually than the touch, because touch I find I use that for basic web scrolling and other things, but when you need more accurate, finer movements, that's where the trackpad comes in, the touch pointer, I'm not used to them. So really, who is this device for? That's what I'm struggling to fathom, that why this device really exists in 2017. It is great to have a pocketable Windows 10 laptop. That I will not deny. It's great, but you know, is it really practical? I think not. The keyboard's frustrating to use. It's just too small. Maybe a GPD came back with something like a 10-inch version of this, or a 9 or 8-inch version, where they could fit a little bit more space in there and perhaps put a small touchpad if they could. That would probably be a little bit better. So there are a couple of real deal breakers on here. For me, the first one is the wireless reception. The range of it is super poor. It's not good at all. I mean, I can walk to the other side of the studio here and the signal strength is just right down on the bottom where it is at the moment, where other laptops will have full signal strength at the moment. So really you have to almost sit on top of your wireless router to get the coverage there. It does get a little too hot once you really push it hard, and if you charge at the same time, and charging times, it is slow to charge, taking around 5 hours. And then of course the keyboard and all those other extras I just mentioned. So have a real long think about, do you really need this device? It's one of those, I feel, gimmicky kind of devices that really serve no true purpose in 2017. Although someone's going to jump onto the comments and say, I disagree with you, Chris. I love the device, I'm using it all the time. I write full whole novels on that keyboard. You know, you're always gonna have someone out there. But it seems anyway, the crowdfunding, there was a lot of demand for this. So there is the market for this, but it's a niche product. And really, I don't think I will be hanging onto this one for long. Thank you so much for watching this review. And if you wanna see the internals of this device here, make sure you check out the unboxing. And I do hope to catch you back in the channel soon. Bye for now.